The Holy One dwells within us, even within this flesh.
Search our hearts, O God.
God has formed us as a people and claimed us as God's own. God has entered into covenant with us, impressing truth on our inmost being.
Breath upon our hearts, O God.
We wait.
With open ears, open eyes, open hearts.
Good morning, beloved community, and welcome to the house of God on this crisp autumn Sunday. Jesus said to his disciples, "My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives." Loved ones, maybe you brought a little extra peace with you this morning, or maybe you're running low, but I invite you to share the peace of Christ, because when you share the peace of Christ, it multiplies. At this time, in a safe, socially distanced manner, I invite you to share the peace of Christ with one another.
Gathered in God's name round the living word, gathered as one family in the name of love.
Loved ones, take a deep breath and take a moment to notice how it feels to be in this place at this time. I am delighted to welcome you to Old South Church in Boston this morning. We are an open and affirming community of humans who take direction from the radical love and forgiveness of Jesus Christ as motivation and inspiration for everything we do. Welcome to those of us who are thinkers and feelers, to we who are questioning and who are doubting. Welcome to those established in this community and those here for the first time, those watching at home in their jammies and those here in the pews. No matter where you come from, no matter who you love, no matter what you look like, no matter your current ability, no matter what burden you bring or how you struggle, you are welcome here. We are a more full and complete reflection of the image of God because we are together in this place. Beloved, we want to know you. Please take a moment, if you haven't yet done so, and fill out the black friendship pad in your pew or pass it to someone who needs it. This gives us the opportunity to learn more about you, and it gives you the opportunity to connect with us. There is a multiplicity of ways to step deeper into the life and workings of the Old South Church community. I direct your attention to the announcements insert in your bulletin for a full list, and I want to point out two things in particular. For those among us who want to get to know Old South Church more, there is an opportunity today at Connections immediately after service upstairs. Please see the insert in your bulletin for more info. Also, mark your calendars for Meeting House Sunday, our festival Thanksgiving worship, a sacred day in the Old South calendar, which is a week from today, Sunday, November 21st at 10 a.m. Those services are at our ancestral home, the Old South Meeting House at 310 Washington Street. Please see the announcement insert for more information. And note, there will be no services here at 645 Boylston Street that day. Carmelite nun and Spanish Christian mystic Teresa of Avila prayed, "Let nothing disturb you. Let nothing frighten you. All things are changing. God alone is changeless. Patience attains the good. One who has God lacks nothing. God alone fills our needs. It is true, beloved, that the one constant of our lives is change. Let us join together in this worship experience, encouraging one another, taking solace and strength from our gathering as we worship God in spirit and in truth. We are so happy that you are here. Welcome."
Done. Oh, hi kids. It's Pastor Sean. Do you want to see my painting? Are you sure? Okay. Ready? Ta-da! It's a self-portrait. It's a painting of me. See? My brown hair and blue eyes? Not so bad, huh? Do you know who is an incredible artist? God. God made, created everyone, everything. And God made us to be just like God, in God's very image. But just like how every work of art is unique, no two people are the same. It's true. Some people have brown hair or blonde hair. Or red hair, or black hair. Some people have smooth hair, or wiry hair, or really, really curly hair. Some people have bigger bodies, and some people have little bodies. Some are tall, and some are short. Some travel on their legs, others travel on wheels. Humans have really different kinds of bodies, and sometimes that feels a bit funny. Our own bodies are funny at times, and other times they can be a bit annoying. Sometimes we want our own bodies to look a bit different. We might want to be taller, or have different colored hair, or have lots of muscles like the Incredible Hulk. And when we get older, we might want more hair or less wrinkles. But God made all bodies in God's image. The short, the tall, the big, and the small. All bodies are beautiful and important because all bodies look like God in some special way. So today, let's love our bodies because they were made especially for us. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for creating us in your image. Help us to value all types of bodies, because all bodies look just like you. And we all say, Amen.
From the Epistle to the Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 19 to 25. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, For he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Word of God.
Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. How are we to meet and experience God? Where do we go to gain insight and wisdom and guidance for our days? When we are uncertain how we should live, where do we turn to seek out the divine? For our faith ancestors, the Israelites, the answer was quite clear. As they journeyed through the wilderness from captivity to liberation and promise, they were led by God as a pillar of cloud and of flame, off in the distance, leading them forward. But on the first day of the month, they would set up the tall, smooth acacia beams and set them in those silver footings and drape them with a cloth of finest linen and threads of red and blue. And there, right in the center, in the tabernacle, in a special place called the Holy of Holies, God would descend and spend some time with the people, alighting upon the golden mercy seat. The high priest, and only the high priest, would enter that inner sanctum to discern the guidance and will of God for the people. But as the composer of the letter to the Hebrews notes, Jesus becomes that high priest for us, opening a new and living way through the curtain. God incarnate in the world, the living Word, fully human and fully divine, and accessible to all people in an entirely new way. As Chris Stead writes in his book, Mindfulness and Christian Spirituality, what incarnation means for us is that we humans can actually know and experience God in the flesh, in our own material bodies and through the material world. We have no other way of experiencing anything, let alone God, other than in our bodies. You are utterly common, and you are miraculous. Somehow, after millions of years of evolution, the stuff of your body got organized into the most complex organism on the face of the planet. Your stuff can recognize a trillion different smells. Your blood vessels can circle the earth four times. Your brain contains 86 billion nerve cells joined together by 100 trillion connections. And if all of the DNA in the 23 pairs of chromosomes in every cell of your body were uncoiled and laid end to end, it would stretch 34 billion miles. That's to Pluto and back three times. Our fully human bodies are miraculous and point directly to the divine, the holy creator. So if, as St. Paul teaches, our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, then we have to recognize that our whole bodies, our whole selves, are sacred, are blessed, and are to be used to worship God. But for some reason, all too often we sterilize our faith. We talk about the body in a detached way, as a metaphor. Our favorite being the church as one body, united in Christ. But we don't often think about our actual physical bodies as instruments of worship and religious experience. But Jesus knew better. He recognized the sacred in the eyes of a man born blind. He was touched by the righteousness of a woman who suffered many years with an issue of blood. Even those who lost hope, lost their grip on reality, even those whose hearts were hardened, even those who were as good as dead to the rest of the world, Jesus knew them as friends, as neighbors, as blessed siblings deserving of love and grace. And Jesus knows us in that way too. Too often and for far too long, religious teaching has caused us to feel shame about our bodies or about parts of ourselves that don't measure up. But Jesus loves all of us, not just our believing minds and faithful hearts. Jesus is our friend and helper, not because of our abilities or gifts. Jesus loves all that makes us up. Bum tickers and misfiring synapses, mobility issues and anxiety disorders, doubt and family baggage. While we may not want to give thanks for the challenges we face, still these parts of us are sacred because they make us who we are. Honestly, humbly, created. This understanding should be a foundation on which we stand to fight against all forms of ableism in our society. While all bodies function differently, that difference in function does not equate to a difference in value. A body with more function is no more sacred than a body with less or different function. Now, if our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, if God is as close as our very heartbeat, our very breath, you may ask yourself, why get up and out of my jammies early on a Sunday morning and go to church? Why log on to the virtual worship service when I'm in the middle of binge-watching Mayor of Eastdown? The author of Hebrews says, we must provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together. We must encourage one another because, beloved, we need every body. Though we can access the Holy Sacred through Christ, who is our friend, we grow stronger and wiser and more spiritually attuned and better equipped to articulate our faith in the world when we are in relationship with one another. The wider the welcome, the closer we come to truly being whole as the one body of Christ, whole as the embodiment of God's love in the world. And this is why we also must make a confession. That in many ways, for far too long, our theology and how we've lived as a faith community has not been entirely accessible to all people. We must be continually about the work of doing accessibility assessments, not only of our church buildings and programs, but also our verbal and written language, and be proactive about welcoming all people fully into the life of our congregation. Being an anti-ableist, just like being an anti-racist, is also not the work of the church alone. We must be willing to evaluate the whole of our society and root out ableism wherever we find it. In the educational system, on the job market, in healthcare, in media, everywhere. While it may make us uncomfortable to face these sins, this is what provoking to love looks like. It is exactly the work of the church to provoke one another to love in just this way. And this kind of provoking only happens when we gather together, every body. One of my favorite phrases that Pastor Nancy sometimes uses to welcome us to worship is this. If you seek to live in love and fellowship with God and all God's people, welcome to Old South Church, for that is our guiding star, though it is far from us and we have not yet arrived. We are seekers. We are provokers. We are bodies with ailments and abilities, and we need one another, because together we are so much possibility. Amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
May the peace of Christ dwell in your hearts.
Christ is our peace, our life, and our hope.
Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, infinite and eternal God, God of the star-studded night, and the turquoise sea. God of craggy mountain and deepest canyon, God of the sturdy rhinoceros and the waddling badger, God of seven continents and five oceans, God of the whole grand unfathomable cosmos, God of love, God of Jesus,
We dare approach the throne of grace with our high thanksgiving. Thanksgiving for all the ways you seek to break through the distance between heaven and earth, between our mortality and your eternity, between spirit and flesh. We come with thanksgiving for prophets, ancient and modern, who dare call us to our highest selves. Thanksgiving for our homes, our families, for friends and colleagues, for those who make us laugh and make us merry, for those who have our backs and cheer us on. Thanksgiving this day for teachers and educators, for coaches and school officials, for all who labor to care for children and youth in these confounding times. O God, we pray your peace for all who sorrow and are sick. Be with any whom the world has despised or hurt, and especially those who are either unloving or unloved. We pray for the strong among us, for those of sound body and alert in mind, that they may be confirmed in their strength and led to use it, that they may do good and not evil through all the days of their lives. We pray for the weak among us, those of humble station or few talents, of weak flesh or troubled hearts or anxious minds, that they may be comforted in their frailty, and that they may see that you can use even their weakness to magnify your power. We pray for the disillusioned among us, those who wanted to believe but cannot, and who hunger for faith but have not found it. May they be steadied on their search until the darkness disappears and the memory of night makes them prophets of the day. We pray now for those unknown to us who visited this sanctuary this past week and asked for our prayers, for those who ask for healing and help for loved ones, prayers for peace among nations and for the safety of children and teachers, healthcare workers, and all in harm's way. And this day we remember before you those who are near and dear to this community, who are in need of your presence. Bob, Barbara, Alice, Tom, David, Marcia, Della, Earl, Etta, and Ed. And not least, we pray for Old South Church in Boston, for its leaders and volunteers, that together we might be a shining vessel of your astounding good news, an embodiment of grace, a promoter of hope, a witness to the ways of peace in a violent world. Indeed, grant to us the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, that by us others may know of your power and your grace. At last we pray, when for each of us night overcomes day, and sight is gone and the journey at last is done, then let us have no fear, but travel in confidence that you are God of the day and of the night, God of our end as God of our beginning, that you have the power to lead us finally home through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
and by. So I decided to give him a try.
As those of you who have already read the letters sent to our community last week know, our senior minister, Nancy Taylor, will be retiring at the end of May after serving this congregation faithfully. If you have not yet had the opportunity to read the letters from both Nancy and our church leaders, I encourage you to spend some time doing so. The letters can be found on the pastoral transition page of oldsouth.org. And on that page, you will also find the timeline of transition and other information that is important to this community process. I hope you will join me and all of us in the months ahead as we find ways to express our gratitude to Nancy for her ministry among us and as we prepare for the way for where God is calling Old South Church next. There is a stunning sanctuary and sturdy hymns. There are heavenly choirs and a reminder that God is not done with us yet. Sunday school classes have been taught upstairs, both physically and virtually, during which children have learned that they are beloved in God's sight. We have a gifted seminarian, a gifted pastoral resident, a faithful senior minister. Food for the hungry, voices for the voiceless, open doors for prayer, for rest, for welcome. Old South Church, we have been given so much, and so now we give thanks. And when Christians give thanks to God, we do so with the best things that we can offer, our hearts and our money. There are many ways that you can join in this God work of giving. You can scan the QR code in your bulletin, visit oldsouth.org/donate, or you can give the old-fashioned way when the plates are passed right now. When we Christians are given so much, we give thanks. This morning's offering will now be received.
I receive the Lord's mercy. the test.
Trust and never doubt, Jesus will surely bring you out.
I know God is able to deliver in times of storm, and I know God will keep you safe from all earthly harm. One day when my weary soul is at rest, I'm going home to be forever blessed. Trust,
he will bring you out. He never failed me yet. I will sing of God's mercy. Every day, every hour, he gives me power. I will sing and give thanks to thee for all the dangers, toils, and snares that he has brought me out. He is my God and I'll serve thee.
No matter what the test,
trust and never doubt,
never doubt.
Jesus will surely bring you out.
Didn't my God deliver Moses from King Pharaoh? And didn't he cool the fire furnace for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? When I think of what my God can do, he delivered Daniel. I know he'll deliver you.
Never.
Let us pray. To you alone, O God, we offer these gifts. Use them to draw your church together into one great company of disciples, together following the way of Jesus Christ into every walk of life. Take our gifts of heart and mind, that they may be used to witness to your everlasting love, justice, and welcome, found in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Following worship, you are invited to join us for a docented tour of the church, which will leave from right under this pulpit. So if you're interested, join us here. There is also a forum up on the second floor on Church Finances 101. Or if you're new to our community and would like to get connected with some of our ministries, Connections is up on the fourth floor. And now, let us go out singing of God's mercy, dancing a dance of hope, and sharing the good news with the whole world. And let us do it with all that we've got. Amen.
Amen.